Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Power of Money: How Governments and Banks Create Money and Help Us All Prosper, by Paul Sheard. Narrated by Michael Langan. Publisher's note: this audiobook contains references to visuals present in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. Money makes the world go round. John Kander and Fred Ebb, Cabaret. Money really does make the world spin, at least the economic world. Without money, the economy as we know it would not exist, and, to borrow from Thomas Hobbes, life would likely be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Imagine if the only way to obtain the things you needed from others was to offer things you have or the services you could provide in exchange. That's called bartering, and it is a recipe for not much getting done in the world. Economic activity would be highly localized and inefficient. Money is so intrinsic to the economy that barter economies likely never really existed, other than in the primordial mists of time and the pages of economics textbooks. Money allows everyone in the global economy to trade with one another indirectly, over space and through time. This is a book about money, but it is not a book about how to make money. There are plenty of those around and better people to write them than me. Rather, I explain money, what it is, how it comes into existence, and how governments, commercial banks, and central banks create it and influence its creation. Understanding money better might help you make money, but I'll leave that to you. Why does the world need another book about money? Because, for all of its importance, and perhaps because of it, misunderstandings, confusions, and controversies about money abound. I'm willing to bet that most of what you think you know about money is suspect, needs serious qualification, or is flat out wrong. Here are a few misconceptions many people have. Money is a simple, unambiguous concept. In fact, it is a surprisingly slippery concept. There is no easy way to define and measure it, and it means different things to different people. It is the central banks like the Federal Reserve in the United States, the European Central Bank, and the Bank of Japan that print money. They can and do in a narrow sense, but it's governments and commercial banks that really print or create money in the first place. Central banks have created trillions of dollars, euros, pounds, yen, and other currencies since the global financial crisis, and again in response to the economic impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. They have not so much created money as they have converted it from one form, government bonds, into another, deposits of banks at the central bank. By racking up such a mountain of debt, the US government is imposing a huge burden on our grandchildren and mortgaging their future. In fact, government debt is an asset for those who hold it and helps society transfer purchasing power, money, into the future. While the government may need to withdraw money from circulation through taxation, it doesn't really need to repay its debt as such. The unequal distribution of money in the world, income and wealth inequality, is an abhorrent and avoidable aspect of market economies. In fact, it is more a feature than a bug of a prosperity-generating system, and has more going for it than much of the usual hand-wringing would suggest. The newest monetary kids on the block, Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies, are set to displace money as we know it. More likely, when they grow up, most of them will be out of a job. What is money? Given the many misconceptions about money, that question turns out to be trickier to answer than it seems. To the ordinary person, money is often synonymous with financial wealth. If someone is very rich, they have a lot of money. But much of that money would not be money as economists define it. Financial wealth, particularly of the very wealthy, typically comprises a range of financial assets such as bank deposits, money market funds, mutual funds, portfolios of individual stocks and bonds, and such alternative investments as hedge funds and private equity funds. Economists, on the other hand, have two ways of defining money, one conceptual, the other empirical. Following the 19th century economist William Stanley Jevons, virtually every economic textbook defines money in terms of the three functions it performs, as a unit of account, a medium of exchange, and a store of value. This functional definition does not identify what money is, but rather what it has to be able to do in order to be considered money. Economists empirically classify money into various categories according to who issues it, the government or commercial banks, how easy it is to use, think a checking account versus a time deposit or a certificate of deposit, and how it functions as a store of value. More on that in the next chapter. Money, being a unit of account, means that prices are quoted in that unit. Dollars and cents in the US, yen, and in the old days, sen, in Japan, euros and cents in much of Europe, pounds and pence in the United Kingdom, and so on, depending on the country. Unit of account status also makes a currency a common benchmark for comparing the value and facilitating the exchange of the myriad goods, services, and assets in an economy. The price of something is just the number of units of money you need to buy it. The unit of account aspect of money extends to all the prices of goods, services, and financial instruments, assets and liabilities, in the economy. In the US, virtually everything is quoted in US dollars. We use money as a medium of exchange when we buy things. I give Starbucks $5, and Starbucks gives me a cup of coffee. Now I have coffee, and Starbucks has $5. Money, being a medium of exchange, is what allows an advanced, dispersed market economy to operate and prosper. As long as I have enough money, I can obtain anything that is for sale. The person selling me the item doesn't have to worry about where I got the money, nor do I have to worry about what that person is going to do with it. Money breaks those nexuses on both sides. The economy produces an amazing array of goods and services, thanks to millennia of civilizational progress and associated scientific discovery and technological and social innovation. All of these goods and services are transacted and tallied in a simple common denominator, money. The US economy produced $25 trillion worth of goods and services in the most recent year, to third quarter 2022. Think about it. We are able to summarize virtually the entire economic activity of the giant US economy with one simple number in an agreed-upon common unit. Money is also a means of transferring purchasing power from the present into the future. If I have $20 in my pocket, I can spend it today or tomorrow. Money, or financial assets more broadly, allows people to save by transferring some of the purchasing power they receive today to a later date, and also to borrow by bringing forward some of the purchasing power they expect to acquire in the future to enjoy today. Money connects the economic past, present, and future. Money, being a good store of value, means that it holds its value, reasonably well at least, over time. If I have $100 today, I can spend it on a fancy meal now or put it away and have that nice meal in a year's time. If I decide to wait, it would be nice if that $100 still fetches me the fancy meal I was looking forward to having, rather than just a club sandwich at the local diner. That's where inflation comes in. The $100 meal exemplifies stored value, but is a little inaccurate because of inflation. In a market economy, prices of individual goods and services rise and fall in response to changes in supply and demand. That's a good thing, because it helps scarce resources to be allocated efficiently in a society. What matters for money holding its value over time is not that prices of individual goods and services remain stable, but that the overall price level does. The overall price level refers to the value of a representative basket of goods and services that a typical consumer might be expected to buy. Changes in this cost of living are what the Consumer Price Index, CPI, and other similar price indices aim to capture. In the modern world, society assigns central banks the primary responsibility for maintaining the purchasing power of money over time, or at least not letting it erode too rapidly. Most central banks do this by targeting a CPI inflation rate of about 2%. More on all of this in Chapter 3. The store of value aspect of money is very broad. All financial assets serve as stores of value in that they allow purchasing power to be transferred across time. But the riskiness of financial assets varies, and with it, their reliability. If a financial asset has to be a stable or very stable store of value to be considered money, that narrows down the range of acceptable candidates. But where to draw the line? The real value of banknotes and other fixed nominal claims can be eroded by inflation or increased by deflation. Banks can default on their deposits, often calling their stability as a store of value into question. Governments counter that risk by insuring bank deposits, up to certain per depositor per bank limits, currently $250,000 in the US. US Treasury securities are widely considered risk-free in terms of coupon payments and the repayment of principal. But despite being a highly stable store of value, they are not conventionally classified as being money. I take issue with this. Over the long run, stocks, particularly a well-diversified portfolio, have proven quite good stores of value, in addition to increasing their value handsomely. The two economies, real and monetary. The economy actually comprises two different but intricately related economies, a real economy and a monetary economy. The real economy is what gross domestic product, GDP, tries to measure. The economy of goods and services that businesses produce using capital equipment and human labor, and that consumers buy and consume, either now, perishables or non-durable goods such as fresh food and taxi rides, or over time, consumer durables such as personal computers and automobiles. The monetary economy is the financial mirror of the real economy. It keeps tabs on the real economy and oils its wheels. The monetary economy is part of the real economy in that the financial and monetary system consumes and employs real resources. Computers, telecommunications networks, managers and workers in the financial sector, and the buildings and other capital equipment they use. The financial sector and its output a part of what is measured as GDP. But the monetary economy is also largely virtual and imagined, a world full of symbols, conventions, and beliefs. It is tempting to think of money as a thing, as something real and tangible. And while it is certainly used to obtain real, tangible things, money is really a social construct. One or more conventions that society adopts and agrees to follow. As historian Yuval Noah Harari has put it, money involved the creation of a new intersubjective reality that exists solely in people's shared imaginations. Money in the modern world is fiat money, or money by decree. A $20 bill has twice the value of a $10 bill, because society deems that it be so, even though the cost of producing the different bills is the same, even more so for monetary entries in banks' computer ledgers. True, banknotes and coins are real things you can see and hold in your hand. But the value or cost of the paper, metal and labour that goes into making currency is just a fraction of what that physical money can buy. The difference accrues to the government as what is called seigniorage, one of the trickier monetary words to spell. And physical money is just a small fraction of the total amount of money that we recognise as existing. Most money is digital, numbers and electronic ledgers. If you have $1,000 in the bank has an electronic record in its computer system containing such information as your name, your account number, and the number of dollars, 1,000. The bank invests in a bunch of assets. Loans, corporate bonds, other risk assets and government bonds. But other than some vault cash and reserves at the country's central bank, there really is no money in the bank. Some people rail against the purported fraudulent nature of this fractional reserve banking system, but it is really a feature of the modern economic system, by and large, a desirable one, not a bug. Money is society's way of tallying who has a claim to the output of the economy and the economic machinery, literal and figurative, that produces it. We can think of money as points that represent purchasing power, now and into the future. Money exhibits very strong network effects. There is a big advantage to everyone being on the same platform. It also solves a coordination problem. As long as I know that other people in society will accept the money I have as payment for the goods, services, or assets they will transfer to me, I will be prepared to receive it in the first place. Money doesn't have to have any intrinsic value, but it will have value if everyone agrees to use it. But how does everybody in society agree to use the same thing as their unit of account, medium of exchange, and store of value? Involving the government in producing and regulating money helps solve that coordination challenge and ensures that the network effects of money are fully captured. A key part of the fiat in fiat money is the government's ability to decree which money it will accept in payment for taxes. That is, what it will accept from me that will extinguish my debt to it. Money as debt. This underscores another key aspect of money, money thought of as debt. Take a look at a $20 bill. It is a Federal Reserve note, a liability of the country's central bank, the Federal Reserve, and has printed on it, "This note is legal tender for all debts, public and private." Not all countries make this clear on their banknotes, but the US puts it in black and white. Or should I say, green and white. This banknote is an asset that its holder can use to extinguish debts. The bill also has the United States of America printed on it, as well as the seal of the United States Treasury, and is signed by the Treasurer of the United States and the Secretary of the Treasury, two distinct positions and people within the U.S. government. The Federal Reserve is an agency of the U.S. government, and banknotes are a form of U.S. government debt. Because banknotes are technically debts of the central bank, they appear on the liability side of a central bank's balance sheet. But what exactly does the central bank owe? In a modern fiat money system, nothing except the banknote itself. A banknote, such as a Federal Reserve note, may be debt, but it is a special kind of debt. One that never has to be repaid. The days are long gone when you could present a banknote to its issuer and demand and receive the gold or silver backing it. If, hypothetically, you were to present that $20 bill at the Federal Reserve and demand that the Fed repay the debt it owes you, the only way it could do so would be to turn around and give you back the $20 bill, or maybe two $10 bills. Or 20 $1 bills. However, if you owe the government $20 in taxes, you can extinguish that debt by presenting the $20 bill after depositing it in a bank account. The government's liability is an asset to you and can be used to wipe out the debt you owe the government by way of your tax obligation. There is a funny thing about what we normally think of as money. Some of it is a debt of the central bank, which means the government, and some of it, in fact, most of it, is a debt of commercial banks. And it is a feature of our monetary system, one we largely take for granted, that money in the form of banknotes, and coins, and as commercial bank deposits, are exchangeable at par, that is, one for one. If you have $100 in the bank owes you $100. If you withdraw that $100 from the bank, the central bank, the government, now owes you $100 instead. By the same token, when you deposit a $100 banknote into your bank account, you are changing your asset from a government debt into a commercial bank debt. This is a manifestation of a broader point and theme of this book. Governments, central banks, and commercial banks are joined at the hip in the creation of money, and fiscal policy and monetary policy are not as distinct and separate as commonly supposed. What's ahead in the book? In Chapter 1, I explore how money in today's world comes into existence, or into circulation, as the jargon goes. Who actually creates the money that we earn when we work, borrow from a bank, or receive when we sell something, or that the government hands out to us? It turns out that commercial banks, the government, and the central bank are all involved in creating money, conceived in the narrow sense of banknotes and bank deposits. Think of all that money, about $20 trillion in the US at the time of writing, sitting in a huge bucket. Banks, the government, and the central bank all have hoses for pouring money in and scoops for taking it out. But as we will see, those hoses are intertwined in a complex way. If we conceive of money in the broadest sense of financial wealth, we see another hose and scoop, one connected to financial markets, particularly the stock market. In Chapter 2, I debunk much of the misunderstanding and alarm that surround government debt levels, about $31 trillion in the US at the time of writing. Running a budget deficit is one way the government gets money into circulation. In principle, a good thing. The government usually turns that money into a different form, that of government bonds, treasuries in the US. Government bonds allow households, businesses, and investors to accumulate wealth and transfer purchasing power into the future. Too much government spending and too high a stock of government debt can create problems for the economy now and in the future, but not because the debt has to be repaid or because it is a burden on future generations. The government, as part of its fiscal policy, may have to raise taxes to drain consumer purchasing power and tamp down inflation, but it never has to tax in order to raise the money to pay down its debt. In Chapter 3, and in the technical handout, I explain how central banks and commercial banks fit into the money creation process and how the monetary policy implemented by central banks works. Much of the money in the economy is created when commercial banks extend loans. Banks don't lend out the deposits they take in. Rather, they create deposits when they lend. Central banks use their control over interest rates to stimulate or restrain bank lending, as needed, doing so to keep inflation in check and the economy humming along. In response to the Great Recession of 2007 to 2009, as triggered by the global financial crisis, and more recently in response to the even sharper February to April 2020 recession, triggered by the COVID-19 pandemic, major central banks eased monetary policy by pumping up their balance sheets in a policy known as quantitative easing, QE. In Chapter 4, I explain what QE is and how it works. QE is commonly described and often decried as massive money printing by central banks, but this is misleading. When QE involves the central bank buying its own government bonds, as it usually does, it is better viewed as changing the form of the money created by prior and ongoing budget deficits. QE can only pump money, liquidity, into the system by sucking assets, usually government bonds, out. In Chapter 5, I zoom out and look at money through a wider lens. The real economy and the monetary economy together produce an enormous amount of wealth and prosperity, but that wealth is very unevenly distributed within and across societies. Reducing inequality has become one of the clarion calls of our time. Here, I look at some of the economic forces behind these wealth disparities, particularly in relation to the emergence of a relatively tiny cohort of the uber-rich. I argue that extreme wealth inequality is, to a significant extent, a byproduct of prosperity-generating market processes, and that, in purely economic terms, the uber-rich do much less harm than is often claimed or assumed. If the government, acting for society, deems it desirable to improve the plight of the poor, it can do so, or at least try to, independently of whether and how it taxes the rich. In Chapter 6, I consider the flip side. Money can also wreak havoc on an economy and society. Financial crises come in many shapes and sizes and are a recurrent theme in modern economic history. The monetary economy helps the real economy do its job of generating prosperity, but the former occasionally goes off the rails and takes the latter with it. There is an inherent mismatch between the liquidity of the financial claims that the monetary economy generates and the illiquidity of the productive assets that comprise the real economy. This mismatch creates the risk of runs on the banking system and, in turn, financial crises. The central bank's role as the lender of last resort empowers it to prevent financial crises and quell those that occur. I argue in this chapter that the Federal Reserve erred in not acting as lender of last resort to Lehman Brothers in September 2008. In Europe, the global financial crisis of 2007 to 2009 morphed into the euro area sovereign debt crisis, which was bookended by a more localized sovereign debt crisis that erupted in Greece in early 2010 and subsided when Greece received a major rescue package from the European Union and International Monetary Fund in mid-2015. In Chapter 7, I argue that the euro area sovereign debt crisis manifested a deep structural flaw in the economic architecture of the euro area. Member states have to pool their monetary sovereignty by forming a single currency and monetary union, but do not also pool their fiscal sovereignty by centralizing budgetary matters and forming a fiscal union. They cede their monetary sovereignty to the European Central Bank while retaining responsibility for their fiscal affairs. The situation that results is tantamount to member nations having to borrow in a foreign currency, one they cannot produce at will. Worse, members of the euro area have to accept stringent fiscal restraints. The book, to this point, examines single currency systems, those of individual countries, or in the case of the euro, of multiple countries sharing the same currency. In Chapter 8, I zoom out in a different way and look at how the myriad currencies or monetary systems of the world fit together and interact with one another. Floating exchange rates, reserve currencies, and the outsized role of the Federal Reserve all play important roles in this process. In Chapter 9, I switch digital gears and look at the latest innovation, a truly remarkable one, in the millennia-spanning history of money: Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. Cryptocurrencies are a product of disruptive 21st century technological innovation and break new monetary ground. Developed out of dissatisfaction with and as an insurgent challenge to sovereign-centered monetary systems, cryptocurrencies eschew central authority and gatekeeping intermediaries by using novel blockchain technology to operate a decentralized peer-to-peer currency and payment system. As audacious and technologically impressive as Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies are, they are not as detached from the legacy monetary system as they appear, and are likely to struggle to compete with it when it comes to fulfilling three canonical roles of money: unit of account, medium of exchange, and store of value. Cryptocurrencies are likely to find a permanent niche in the monetary ecosystem, however, and may still be early in their innovation cycle, making definitive predictions treacherous. At the very least, the advent of cryptocurrencies is shaking up the existing sovereign-based monetary system. Every major central bank is now actively exploring the feasibility and desirability of introducing its own central bank digital currency. Rather than seriously challenge, let alone displace, the traditional monetary system, it seems more likely that cryptocurrencies and their foundational technologies, by spurring innovation, will help to reshape it. Last, I offer concluding thoughts to tie these threads together with an eye to the future of money. 1. Money creation, a powerful partnership. We thus have side by side state money or money proper, and bank money or acknowledgements of debt. But the tendency is towards a preponderant importance for bank money, and towards state money occupying a definitely subsidiary position. John Maynard Keynes, 1930. Where does money come from? That is, how does money spring into existence or enter circulation in the modern economy? The answer is crucial to understanding how the economy operates and is influenced by the economic policies of governments and central banks. When it comes to dissecting today's economic controversies, the dynamics of money creation hold the key to separating fact from fiction. The question of how money is created today differs from that of how the institution of money came into existence in the first place and developed through history. There are many fascinating histories of money. They tell a story of money coming into existence and slowly evolving over the centuries into one of the key institutional underpinnings of the modern market economy. Money is a testament to the power of human ingenuity. The typical account emphasizes the idea that monies of various forms evolved to eliminate the manifest inefficiencies associated with trade in a barter economy, solving the double coincidence of wants problem. Let's say I have shoes and you have bread, and I want your bread, but you want vegetables, not my shoes. Then I have to find someone with vegetables who wants my shoes so that I can get them as payment for the bread I want from you. How much more convenient and efficient it would be if there were one common unit and medium of exchange in which we could all transact. Money coming into existence as a solution to the double coincidence of wants problem, and thereby unlocking the gains from trade and propelling economic prosperity, is a compelling story. It probably didn't take our ancestors long, however, to figure out how to ditch barter in favor of some form of money or a system for keeping tabs on who owes what to whom. There is even some evidence that monkeys can be taught to use money. Barter likely gave way to some form of money very early in human civilizational development. Metal coins issued by kings and emperors feature prominently in the early part of money's history, as the abundant museum collections of coins from the ages attest. Histories of money then usually describe how paper money was adopted and helped birth the modern banking system. When owners of precious metals and other valuable items such as grain deposited them with warehouse operators, they received receipts, and these receipts started to circulate as money, an IOU of the issuer, but a claim on something valuable for the holder, that is, purchasing power. Commodity-backed money was born. There typically follows an account of how money backed by something evolved into money backed by nothing at all besides the full faith and credit of a sovereign government. Fiat money, Fiat means that such money has value because the government says it has. But the actual reason it has value is because lots of people use it. In my exploration of money, however, I probe a different set of questions. Where does money come from, and how does it get into existence and circulation in the modern-day economy and monetary system? These might strike you as strange or obvious. Most people work for a living, at least at some stage in their life. They earn money for labor and sometimes make more by investing some of it. That's where it seems like money comes from, your job, and from saving and investing. But that doesn't really answer the question. It just moves it around one space. Your employer deposited your pay into your bank account, where it became your money, but that just means they transferred it from their account. How did the money get into their bank account? Your employer, if it is a business, has customers and sales revenue, and the money in its bank account came from the bank accounts of those customers. Where did those folks get it from? Now we are going round in circles, like a dog chasing its tail. Money moves around the economy from one person or business to another, but it has to originate somewhere. We need to step back and ask how money first enters circulation. It wasn't always there. Economies are expanding all the time, and new money is constantly coming into existence, as the monetary economy mirrors and supports the real economy. The US is now, according to the latest data available as of December 2022, a $25 trillion economy with $2.2 trillion in banknotes and $17.8 trillion in commercial bank deposits. 20 years ago, it was a $10.7 trillion economy with $625 billion in banknotes and $4.2 trillion in bank deposits. Where did all that money come from? One answer would be bank deposits arise or increase when people put money, banknotes, in the bank. That is true as far as it goes. If I take a wad of $100 bills to my bank, say 100 of them, and deposit them in my bank account, my deposit balance and bank deposits in the overall economy will go up by $10,000. But that doesn't say very much. First of all, banknotes make up only a small percentage of the money supply in most economies. Even if everyone deposited all their banknotes in banks, bank deposit money would go up by only 12%. Hardly a game changer in a $25 trillion economy. The Federal Reserve does not dispense banknotes directly. Rather, they come out of bank deposit accounts. Every dollar of banknotes in circulation started life in a bank account. So, we are going round in circles again. Where do bank deposits come from? Enough suspense. Every dollar in a bank account started life in one of three ways. A bank created it when it made a loan. The government created it when it spent and didn't withdraw it by taxing, i.e. when it ran a budget deficit. Or the central bank created it when it bought a government debt security, or other asset, from the public at large. Banks, the government, and the central bank are all involved in the creation of money, in their own ways, as part of an interconnected system. In every case, the money was conjured up out of thin air, or more accurately, with the tap of a computer key. That is the mystery of modern money. But before we get into that, a brief detour on measuring money is in order. Taking the measure of money. Economists have developed a method of classifying money in terms of increasingly broader and less liquid forms of money supply. Liabilities issued by central banks and commercial banks, or other financial intermediaries. Termed monetary aggregates, these are typically denoted by ascending levels of M, as in MB, monetary base, M0, M1, M2, and M3, corresponding to ever wider sets of money-like financial instruments or assets. The classification differs slightly depending on the country. This is sometimes likened to an inverted monetary pyramid. It is a useful pedagogical device, but can invite confusion. At the base of the monetary pyramid, actually the tip because it is inverted, are bank reserves, or just reserves, the deposits of banks at the central bank. These reserves, which are not to be confused with foreign exchange reserves, play a critical role in the monetary system. It is in these accounts that the ultimate settlement, or netting out, of financial transactions in the economy occurs, and they play a pivotal role in the central bank's conduct of monetary policy. Banknotes and coins in circulation, that is, cash held by the public, expressed as M0, and reserves make up the monetary base, or base money, MB. The monetary base largely corresponds to the liability side of a central bank's balance sheet. Roughly speaking, M1 adds checking accounts and demand deposits to M0. M2 adds savings accounts, small denomination time deposits, and retail money market funds to that. And M3 adds large denomination time deposits, institutional money market funds, and short-term repurchase agreements. In this conventional classification, money debt securities, treasury bills and bonds, are not regarded as money, something I take issue with in this book. Further, reserves, the key part of the monetary base, are, somewhat confusingly, not considered part of the M0 and higher monetary aggregates. The key idea behind this classification and the distinction between narrow and broad money is that the closer money is to the base, the more it is used to make payments. The further away it is, the more it serves as a store of value. But there is no bright line between when money stops being money and starts becoming a non-monetary financial asset from the holder's point of view. And what characteristics the various categories of money have depends considerably on financial innovation and regulation. The different categories of money reflect what kind of liability, including the kinds of services attached to it, the bank chooses and is allowed, by regulation, to issue. This menu has shifted over time with financial deregulation and innovation. It is the medium of exchange aspect of money that maps most closely to economists' monetary aggregates classification of money. Reserves, banknotes and coins, checking accounts and demand deposits are the forms of money most commonly and readily used to make the payments associated with purchasing goods, services, and assets. But again, there is no bright line. Financial innovation and regulation have shifted the border, and will do so again. In this way, money, rather than being a clearly and unambiguously identifiable thing like water or gold, is multifaceted and varies along a spectrum. The unit of account aspect of money pertains to all assets and transactions in the economy. Similarly, the store of value aspect of money pertains to all assets, whether financial, such as stocks and bonds, or real, such as automobiles and houses. They all serve to translate current into future purchasing power or command over the services that assets provide. What shifts across a spectrum here is how good the respective assets are as stores of value, notably how risky they are. How much shares in a company will sell for in the future is highly uncertain, the more so the further into the future one looks. The price may go up, but in principle, and less pleasant, it could go to zero. Stocks are a store of value, but they are a risky one. Money as a medium of exchange is more circumscribed. Banks settle transactions among themselves using their accounts at the central bank, known as reserve accounts, the money in those accounts being known as reserves. Banknotes and coins are used as a medium of exchange, mainly by individuals, in many small lot transactions. Individuals and businesses mainly use checking and demand deposit accounts to settle their transactions, which they typically engage in by using credit and debit cards or electronic wallets and similar payment services. But other forms of money that cannot be directly used as a medium of exchange, more by via virtue of custom and convention, that is, self-imposed rules, than technological feasibility, such as savings and term deposits or government bonds, are readily convertible into forms that can. Now, back to how money comes into existence. Banks create money. Most existing money in deposits was created by commercial banks. Banks create money when they make loans. The act of a bank making a loan is the act of it simultaneously crediting the deposit account of the loan's recipient, the borrower. That banks create money when they make loans surprises many people because we are so used to hearing the opposite. Banks collect or take in deposits and use those deposits to make or fund new loans. Deposits would seem to come before loans rather than being a necessary consequence of them. Banks lend out their deposits, which in turn fund loans, correct? Not so. This way of describing things is so ingrained it even has a name: the loanable funds theory. It dominates the popular imagination, even the academic one, but it is flat out wrong. It is actually the other way around. Deposits do not allow banks to create loans. Loans create deposits, in the sense that the act of a bank making a loan is one of it crediting the borrower with a deposit. Deposits fund loans only in the sense that the two sides of a bank's balance sheet must balance. Part of the confusion stems from the standard financial language used, particularly the words fund and finance. If a company wants to buy some new equipment or significantly expand its business, it likely won't have enough cash on hand and will need to borrow money from a bank. It makes sense to say that the company finances or funds its business expansion by taking out a loan from its bank. Without the loan, the business expansion wouldn't happen. The new loan by the bank creates the money that the company needs and uses to finance its business expansion. However, banks don't function that way. They don't attract deposits and then use those deposits to fund the loans they make. It may look that way, but that is an optical illusion. To understand this better, it's useful to look at a simplified bank balance sheet, which in this case omits equity for simplicity. A balance sheet, as the name suggests, has two sides that needs to balance. By convention, assets are recorded on the left-hand side and liabilities and equity on the right-hand side. What you have and what you owe, or how you finance the purchase of the assets respectively. Assets column. Reserves, interbank loans, loans. Liabilities column. Central bank loans, interbank loans, deposits. Reserves are a bank's deposits with the central bank, which the central bank can supply by buying assets from the bank or from someone with a deposit account with the bank, or by directly lending them, central bank loans. Banks can lend these reserves to one another, but not to anyone else. So interbank loans can be an asset or a liability, depending on which bank is lending and which is borrowing them. Imagine that the bank wants to make a new loan of $10. Does it need to find $10 in deposits from somewhere and then lend that $10 to the borrower? No. The bank just creates the $10 loan and the $10 deposits out of thin air. It just marks up its loans by $10 and credits $10 to the deposit account of the borrower, with a bit of legal paperwork thrown in. Now, the borrower wants to borrow that $10 for a reason, and the first thing they will likely do is spend or use the money for whatever purpose they decided to borrow it. There are a couple of cases to consider. Let's assume that whoever received the $10 from the borrower has an account at the same bank and keeps it on deposit there. Then, although the deposit changes hands, the bank does not have to attract any new deposits. The loan, in effect, is self-financing. but assume the deposit leaves the bank in question and becomes a deposit of another bank, that of whoever received the $10 from the borrower. The borrower's bank will accommodate the $10 deposit outflow by running down its reserves, deposits, at the central bank by $10. The receiving bank's deposits will increase by $10, matched by an increase of $10 in its reserves at the central bank. For the banking system as a whole, deposits and reserves will be unchanged. They will just have moved between banks. The new loan is not self-financing for the initiating bank anymore, but it is for the banking system as a whole. The individual banks won't see or feel it that way, however. Suddenly, as a result of making a $10 loan, the first bank is short of reserves by $10, and the other bank has $10 too much in reserves. Banks cannot lend their reserves to anyone that doesn't have an account at the central bank, but they can lend them to one another. They do this in what is called the interbank money market, or overnight call market, applying the interest rate set by the central bank. More on why and the mechanics of that in Chapter 3. So, most likely, the bank with the $10 in surplus reserves will lend it to the bank that is $10 short of reserves, and Bob's your uncle. Yet, it is not quite that simple. Banks need three things in order to make loans. The most important is a willing borrower on the terms that the bank finds it profitable for it to want to extend a loan. Without a willing borrower that is attractive to the bank, bank credit creation doesn't get to first base. The second is sufficient capital, since banks face capital adequacy requirements set by their regulators. Suppose that the lending bank was just meeting its capital adequacy requirements before making the new loan. Now it is short of capital and will need to raise more, or shrink some of its other assets, including possibly securitizing the loan it just made. That is, making part of it a security that it can sell to investors. A healthy bank that is making profitable loans, i.e. loans likely to be repaid with an amount of net interest more than compensating for the risk of default, should have no trouble raising the necessary capital to support the expansion of its loan book. The third thing a bank needs is sufficient reserves, because central banks impose on commercial banks minimum reserve requirements linked to the amount of deposits they have. These have taken a back seat after years of central bank quantitative easing, QE, the act of central banks pumping up their balance sheets in an attempt to stimulate the economy. This is because QE floods banks with reserves, making minimum reserve requirements moot. More on QE in Chapter 4. The idea of minimum reserve requirements is to ensure that banks have sufficient liquid funds, money, on hand to meet the withdrawal demands of their customers without having to call on the central bank to provide those funds in a scramble. Banks have to maintain an amount of reserves on the asset or left-hand side of the balance sheet, corresponding to a certain percentage of the deposits they have on the liability or right-hand side. Because more loans create more deposits, and assuming that the bank was just meeting its minimum reserve requirements before it made the new loan, it will need to hold more reserves now. Not to worry, the central bank will always provide the necessary reserves to the banking system. To understand why minimum reserve requirements are never a constraint, consider a simplified central bank balance sheet. Assets column, government bonds. Liabilities column, reserves, government deposits, banknotes. Being a balance sheet, one side must equal the other. Rearranging the balance sheet's identity and expressing it in change terms, we can see that an increase, decrease, in reserves occurs when one or more of the following happens. The central bank buys, sells, government bonds. The government decreases, increases, its deposits at the central bank, or the public decreases, increases, its holdings of banknotes. If there are too many reserves, the central bank can extinguish the excess by selling government bonds to banks or the public. If there are not enough, it can make up the shortfall by buying bonds. Often, central banks don't buy and sell government bonds outright, but do so under short-term repurchase agreements, or repos. Under a repo, the central bank buys a security from a bank with an agreement to sell it back again after a short specified period, usually the next day. Buying the security increases the central bank's reserves by that amount. Selling it back extinguishes them. Under a reverse repurchase or reverse repo operation, the central bank sells a security to the bank with an agreement to buy it back again after a short specified period, usually the next day. Selling the security drains or extinguishes the central bank's reserves by that amount. Buying it back restores them. Since the global financial crisis and then again with the COVID-19 pandemic, central banks have often been operating in or near zero interest rate territory and doing QE. In normal times, however, central banks seek to keep the aggregate amount of reserves roughly in line with the amount corresponding to total minimum reserve requirements. In fact, because central banks historically did not pay any interest on reserves before these crises, they had to operate this way in order to keep short-term interest rates in line with their target. Because flows in and out of reserve accounts are subject to fairly predictable daily and seasonal patterns, central banks often prefer to offset them using repos rather than outright purchases or sales. A useful analogy for understanding how central banks operate is a leaky bucket into which water is flowing from a tap. Water flows in and leaks out, respectively, in an irregular if somewhat predictable way. Imagine that the bucket has a water line marking the amount of water that needs to be maintained in the bucket at all times. It is the central bank's job to make sure the amount of water stays at the water line. To do this, it has a scoop and a hose. If the flow of water in and out of the bucket is such that the water level is above the water line, the central bank scoops enough water out to bring it down. If the water level falls below the water line, the bank uses its hose to top it up. Because banks, in aggregate, have to maintain at least the amount mandated by the central bank-imposed minimum reserve requirements, the central bank has to supply at least that amount. Failure to do so would leave some banks short of reserves, even when all other banks had just secured enough. The resulting scramble for reserves by those banks would push the interbank interest rate, in the US, the federal funds rate, above the interest rate targeted by the central bank. But why does the central bank have to ensure that there are not too many reserves? That is, scoop water out of the bucket when it rises above the waterline? For an analogous reason. Until fairly recently, the Fed and other major central banks did not pay interest on the reserves held by banks. That meant that banks, having secured their needed amount of reserves, generally did not want to hold any more. So if they ended up holding too many reserves due to the flows in and out of their little buckets, which in aggregate make up the big bucket that the central bank manages, they would want to lend them at the prevailing interbank interest rate, which the central bank will adjust, using its scoop and hose, to keep in line with its interest rate target. If the aggregate amount of reserves exceeds the amount corresponding to the total of the individual bank's minimum reserve requirements, some banks will have excess reserves after all the other banks have secured just enough, but none in excess. These banks will then try, in vain, to offload these reserves to other banks, putting downward pressure on the interbank interest rate in the process and forcing it below the central bank's target. So, if the central bank wants to do its job of hitting its interest rate target, it has to make sure there are neither too many nor too few reserves. The water level has to be just at the line. We see here again the importance of the distinction between the reserves level of an individual bank and that of the banking system as a whole. All banks. The central bank can, and generally does, control the level of reserves in the entire banking system. How it does so is intricately related to how it conducts monetary policy. In particular, whether it is operating a normal interest rate regime, is doing quantitative easing, or is operating with the legacy of a QE bloated balance sheet. More on QE in Chapter 4. But if one bank is short of reserves because it increased its lending, the central bank doesn't need to provide reserves to that bank. It can just make sure that the banking system as a whole has enough reserves and rely on the fact that banks that end up with more reserves than they need will lend those reserves in the interbank market to banks that are short. The individual bank-banking system reserves distinction is also useful when considering how loans are financed. I put financed in quotes because, in an important sense, that of the system as a whole, loans are self-financing, because a corollary of lending is the act of creating deposits. But it doesn't feel that way for an individual bank. Loans typically being quite illiquid, deposits inherently being fleet of foot. After all, the first thing a borrower usually does with the money it receives from the bank is to spend it. But even if the entirety of the deposit...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.